SpaceX getting ready for Raptor ignition on Booster 7. Mechazilla 2 at the Cape is close to stacking. NASA SLS gets green light for Moonshot. Let's dive right in.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? It's a perfect time to be a space enthusiast. Two mega rockets are nearing their first launch. The race between SpaceX's Starship and NASA's SLS is at the finish line and we're here to witness it all. Starship updates. Jumping right into today's Starship updates, SpaceX is working towards their most important goal yet for the Starship development program. Twice. This segment of What About It is slowly changing. Changing into something we already had before when the old COCO Starship development side was still operational. And you can tell how far SpaceX has come since then. This is a Starlink satellite dispenser and it is being lowered into Ship 25's payload section. It is the structure inside the payload bay of a Starship responsible for holding the Starlink satellites in place on the ascent and for pushing them down and out of the very narrow slit-like payload door when in orbit. This is specialized equipment. This dispenser will only be able to do one thing. I talked about an idea 2 years ago. This would mean that the cargo Starships are made of two separate parts, an engine section and a fairing section. The same we already see in the prototype process right now. Those two halves then would be interchangeable. This would basically make the Starship the Swiss pocket knife of rockets. I called it the Swiss Army Knife Starship. What if SpaceX would make different fairing sections for different tasks? I went wild with the idea. How about an asteroid miner Starship with special gear in the front? How about a station builder or a tanker? It seems I wasn't too far off with my idea. Ship 24 and likely many after it are a special variant of Starships. PES Starships, only capable of doing one task, transporting and deploying Starlink satellites. And it's hard to overstate what big of a deal this actually is. Name one other rocket that was designed for one payload only. The whole upper stage is only capable of one task. This is not the Starship that will get us to the moon or to Mars. Back then, I speculated that SpaceX even might put some sort of connector in between the upper stage tank section and the tool, as I called it, the modified fairing section. What do you think? How many variants will we see? Go wild and give me your ideas of variants in the comments. SpaceX is also preparing to utilize their Can Crusher for another test run. On June 16th, they moved the impressive looking top part out to the launch site. And this test tank will see its big moment soon. Its SpaceX designation is B7.1. SpaceX has its own department at Starbase for these tanks. The test tank team. Test tanks like B7.1 are built to validate different designs and construction methods, different steel thicknesses, and different tank dome designs. All these new ideas need to be put to the test before they can be implemented in later Starship designs. So what does the Can Crusher actually do? How does it work? Orbe from SpaceX 3D Creation Eccentric has us covered with one of his ultra accurate animations. Can Crusher is just the name we Starship fans gave to this contraption. Its actual name would be the Max-Q Test Rig. And this already tells you much more about its purpose. A test tank is lifted onto the base of the machine, then the top part we saw in Chief's footage is put on top and the ropes connect the top part with the base. And those two parts pull towards each other while pushing the tank at the bottom. Squeeze! It's a bit hard to see with the tank on it, so let's take that out for a second. Now you can see what's going on under the tank. Hydraulic ramps simulate thrust from the booster's engines while the top part gets pressed down with the ropes on the outside. So the rig tests simulated engine thrust and Max-Q pressure at the same time, giving the SpaceX engineers very realistic feedback on the behavior of the tank at Max-Q conditions. Max-Q, of course, refers to the point of maximum aerodynamic pressure a rocket experiences shortly after liftoff. It's the point at which atmosphere thickness and vehicle speed culminate, creating the largest amount of force on the vehicle during the entire flight. While all this is in progress at the same time, SpaceX is finding time to start the final segment of Super Heavy Booster 7's test campaign, static fires. Booster 7 has visited the launch site before. The big difference now is that it has 33 Raptor 2 engines installed under its engine skirt. And there's only one reason for this. Static fires are incoming. First one engine at a time, later all of them. Closures are scheduled from the 27th to the 29th as of recording this episode. Those could be the days you should mark on your calendars for Super Heavy static fires. The test windows stretch from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m., which could be an indicator of the static fires. These tests take a lot of preparation time. In general, a surge of workers coming from SpaceX facilities all over the country can be seen right now. Work on the Star Factory is progressing fast. Foundations are being laid for future mass production. At first, we'll likely see many Starlink Starships leave these factory halls. Money needs to be made. Starships need to be profitable. Now that the FAA has at least greenlit Starbase itself with 75 tasks to do before a launch license can be requested, SpaceX has the approval it needed. Remember how I said twice when talking about SpaceX's most important goal for the Starship development program in the beginning of this video? This is why. The Starship update segment is finally back to two locations. Starship Florida is in full swing. This is Sean, or Planet Deimos from Twitter, on a nightly visit to the VAB. And this is the team from Spaceflight now filming the same scene. It happened roughly 14 miles away from my front door at the NASA Vehicle Assembly Building on June 22nd. In 1 week, SpaceX rolled out two segments for the second Mechazilla. The concrete base for the tower is already in place and stacking should begin shortly with a Leaper LR11350 crane already in place at Pad 39A as well. And it's not the only progress. This is a picture sent to me by Noisemaker, and it shows a part of the Kennedy Space Center Mechazilla chopsticks. The giant steel arms attached to the Starship launch tower are responsible for lifting and catching boosters and Starships during and after a launch. He showed up at our recent Jetty Park meetup, and we had a talk about how fast SpaceX's progress at Kennedy Space Center is right now. Do you like today's episode? Supporting us here at Why is as easy as clicking the like button, subscribing to the channel, or becoming a channel member by hitting the join button right below the video. Or head over to Patreon by following the link in the description and become an active supporter. Or buy yourself a new shirt in the Whywear store if you fancy cool space merch. Thank you so much. Artemis 1 update. SpaceX isn't the only team getting ready for the big milestone. After decades of development, SLS, NASA's Space Launch System, is getting ready for the moonshot. This is it, the Space Launch System. Not in its largest configuration, as the proposed extended exploration upper stage is still missing, but that won't be needed for the first flight. Artemis 1. It underwent its fourth wet dress rehearsal at Kennedy Space Center's Pad 39B on June 20th. Not everything went perfectly smoothly. A wet dress rehearsal is a simulated launch attempt. Everything needed for a launch is performed step by step as if it was a launch day. The plan was to stop the countdown at T-minus 9 seconds. This is when, on a real launch, the main engine ignition occurs. The countdown was stopped at T-minus 29 seconds instead. This was due to a modified timeline the team agreed on earlier that day. They detected a leak at the quick disconnect for the core stage hydrogen. To proceed with the test until T-minus 29 seconds, data was masked so that the internal flight computer would not shut down the sequence. NASA stated after the rehearsal that this was a minor issue. This was the last wet dress rehearsal before the launch. Next, SLS will be rolled back into the VAB, likely on June 27th. After that, preparations for the launch will begin. NASA is still confident that a launch can happen no earlier than late August, and the launch window lasts until mid-September. Artemis 1 will send an uncrewed Orion capsule around the moon and return it back to Earth. This will pave the way for Artemis 2, which will see a crew of 4 astronauts embark on a 10-day flight around the moon. Currently slated for no earlier than May 2024, Artemis 2 will be the first time astronauts reach the moon after the Apollo program ended with Apollo 17's landing on December 19th of 1972, almost 50 years ago. SpaceX triple launch. Jumping back to SpaceX, I'd like to mention a very special weekend, June 17th to June 19th. And I'm actually not talking about three full days, just the time between June 17th at 12.09 p.m. and June 19th at 12.27 a.m. That's one day, 12 hours and 18 minutes. Three launches in 36 hours, Starlink 419, SARah 1 and Globalstar FM15. One from Pad 39A, one from Vandenberg, and one from Slick 41. I was of course present at both the launches from Kennedy Space Center. On June 19th, so after the Jetty Park fan meetup, we went there again just before midnight and watched Globalstar FM15 go up in the middle of the night while celebrating my friend Galen's 42nd birthday. That's a birthday candle with style. Happy birthday, Galen. Besides demonstrating its know-how once again by launching three Falcon 9 rockets from three different pads with zero problems within 36 hours, SpaceX also created the best ever landing video of a Falcon 9 on a drone ship in the history of the company. How? Starlink. Crystal clear 4K video from the middle of the Atlantic Ocean and a booster landing we've never seen so crisp and clear. This was the 13th landing of Booster B1060. Let me show you the difference between any other rocket and a Falcon 9 rocket. GPS 3 on June 30, 2020. Starlink L11 on September 3rd of 2020. Starlink L14 on October 24th of 2020. Turkeysat 5A on January 8th of 2021. Starlink L18 on February 4th of 2021. Starlink L22, March 24th, when I turned 41 in 2021. Starlink L24, April 29th, 2021. Transporter 2, June 30th, 2021. Starlink Group 43, December 2nd, 2021. Starlink Group 46, January 19th, 2022. Starlink Group 49, March 3rd, 2022, Starlink Group 414, April 21st, 2022, and now Starlink Group 419, June 17th, 2022. That's the difference between SpaceX and any other launch provider in the world. SpaceX collects data from every flight they perform to improve their rockets further and further. The same goes for all of us. Lots of data points help everyone improve every day. But what to do if that data works against you? You get incogni. Every time you type something into Google, so-called data brokers get more information about you. Sometimes that's even useful for you. But what if there's a breach? If one of those data brokers loses control? What if all your data is leaked out? It happens all the time. In that case, you have a problem. Ever wondered why you get so much spam email every day or why your health insurance bill goes up after you Google a serious disease? It's because data brokers are not playing fair. They don't clean up the mess they create. Governments have given you the right to get the data deleted, but there are so many places where your data can be found, it would take years to get it deleted by sending emails and requesting deletion. So we don't do it. The system is broken by design. There's a solution. Incogni helps you protect your privacy and take your personal data off the market by reaching out to data brokers on your behalf, requesting your personal data removal, and even dealing with their objections. Fully automated, system fixed. Create an account, grant the right to work for you, and kick back and watch Incogni work. Reports about success included. And they are so confident that you even get a 30-day money-back guarantee. The first 100 people to use my promo code FELIX at the link in the description will get 20% off of Incogni. Protect your privacy and help What About It at the same time. Incogni.com/FELIX. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Bob Brink, Alexander Baal, Joshua Wiggins, Bob Luce, Richard Kjazek, Steve Larive, Javier Lopez, Bodo, Kanathar, Mike Brutero, Dryfrog, and many others. You rock so much. Thank you for showing us over and over again how much our work means to you. Keep a lookout for the next Y meetup, enjoy today's ad-free and early release, and remember to hop on our supporter exclusive Discord where you can talk to the Y family, including me. Sometimes I do these recordings where in the end I really can't talk anymore. Very narrow slit-like pickle door. Excuse me. The Swiss Army, Swiss. pairing sections for different tasks. Favorites for variants in the comments. I can do this. Then the top part we saw on Chief's footage is put on top on, and the ropes connect the top part with the base. Then ropes on the outside. On the outside, it's not so bad.